Thank you. Yeah, so I will not talk about identifiers, I will not talk about data citation or any other practical and technical things, but I'll give an overview of how things are in daily life of one specific university, namely Aalto University, the second biggest university in Finland. Thank you, Pekka. Thank you, Pekka. Yes. Yes. So, opening research data or not opening research data? That's a tricky question. Aalto's strategic goal is paraphrased as optimal use and reuse of research data. Well, we have copied this from Horizon 2020, so it's not our own. But anyway, we don't strive for opening everything because we are a university for which innovation activities are at the core of our strategy. So sometimes innovation and commercialization and patenting and so on will prevent opening of the data. But instead we wish to ensure that research results can be used as business assets to achieve benefits for society as a whole. And if you think about society as a whole, then sometimes really it is commercial products that bring a lot of good for society. And this is sometimes in contrast with opening your data. So we encourage both. We encourage opening and we encourage careful decision making on when to open and when not. And then what is who makes the decision on opening? Finally, it is the professor who is in charge of the research. So it's not the university itself. No matter who really owns the data, you might know that in some cases the data is actually owned by the researcher, and in some cases it's owned by the university. And this depends on where the funding came from. But anyway, for us, it is the professor in charge who can make the decision on opening and to which degree the data is open and where it is open, I mean in which repository. And they will take into consideration all the legal and sensitivity aspects and commercial interests and policies and law and so on. But most of all, we encourage the careful data management, whether or not this is about opening your data. And we are trying to pay some attention on the infrastructure of data, research data. So we are in the process of providing researchers infrastructure which we leverage on national and international work. So we are not building the repositories ourselves, at least not much of them, but we will maximally leverage on for example the work that CSC, the National IT Center for Science, what CSC is doing, and also let's say Zenodo or OpenAir or other international public service providers. And we will need to build some own infrastructure, of course, because there is data that nobody will want to give outside the rooms, outside the doors of the university. So there will be some small infrastructure built within the university, but that's not going to be much. And the researcher can decide on where to put the data, and we offer, from the services point of view, we offer support for some repositories, let's say the national ones and Zenodo and so on. And we also try to recommend people to choose a license when they are opening the data, so that everybody knows on which ground the data can be used and how not. Recently we have opened a web page listing all the services we have for research data management. So this is both for opening your data and storing the data that's not going to be opened. So it includes data management planning and storage and collaboration and publishing and so on. And this is of course open to everybody, so this is not just for Aalto University researchers, but everybody can see it, and some of the services are of course not just restricted to Aalto University, but they are public services, so the web page might be useful for people in other universities also. Yes, about this licensing that I already mentioned briefly, we try to encourage people to choose the license. This will help, for example, when people are moving out of the university, so that the research group who remains in the university can still use the data and has specific rules on how the data can be used. So that when people leave, the person who has created the data, when they leave, then somebody else can still benefit the data. And of course, this also applies to third parties. And since the researchers are sometimes not very happy about the idea of opening and licensing, we try to emphasize that you can choose an embargo period to make sure that you can first get the benefit yourself before opening. This is not something that everybody knows. And we recommend Creative Commons Attribution CC BY4 for data and the MIT license for software. I think the recommendation is same for this ATT project in Finland. Then I'll say a few words about metadata, how we are solving the question. We are planning to build a metadata repository of the data sets that have been created by Aalto's researchers, no matter where the data are. A catalog of them will be accumulated in Aalto's research information system. The name of the system is ACRIS, so it is a CRIS system. It's run by Elsevier, so it's a pure, the name of the system is pure, and it's owned by Elsevier. And many Finnish universities have similar system. For example, University of Helsinki has kind of a similar system. So we have decided that this CRIS system is the place where we accumulate the total metadata catalog of all data sets that our researchers have put in various repositories. This is handy in the sense that we also use the system for other reporting purposes. And then we also harvest the metadata from our own repository to ETSIN, which is the national metadata catalog of CSC. So in the end, the metadata will be in two places, but it's automatically harvested, so there's no extra worry for the researcher. But in this way, we ensure that we have all the reporting capabilities inside the university, and then again, it's listed in national services also. This ACRIS, as you know, the CRIS information, the research information systems, they also they are mainly used for storing data on publications and patents and teaching and awards and merits. And in fact, this ACRIS system, it can also store data sets. Of course, they are small. I mean, the capacity is not very high. But for researchers who otherwise are not familiar with some international repositories, then this is an easy way to support them in at least storing the data somewhere. Because this is where they will anyway need to put their publications and teaching activities and other personal merits. Well, yeah, this is provided by Elsevier, which is a commercial provider, but we thought that, well, we are not giving, well actually we are giving our metadata to Elsevier for free, but then again we are also giving it to the Ministry of Education's Etsin catalog, so it's in both places, so we are not like trapped by this commercial provider, which might be a worrying case sometimes. We've all seen that we give our publications free to the publishers and then they charge us highly on getting them back, so we don't know if the same will happen with data or metadata, but this is something that we have to keep an eye on. I'll have another figure on how we plan to make things in the optimal case. So in the right corner there's our own system, and then here in the middle on red printed on red there are these national Etsin is the national repository, and then we hope it could, well probably it is, it's harvested to open air, and then it's also harvested back and forth with the data repositories. So we have a lot of harvesting in mind. Yes, and actually we are hoping that the national IT provider CSC would build some harvestings. Probably they already do some of these, that they would harvest from international repositories, that they would harvest to Etsin, and then again we are building a harvesting from our own system to Etsin, so that information would flow naturally everywhere. Another thing that we would be happy to see, and we don't know if it is possible, but we are trying to negotiate with CSC, is to provide the HACA, so that's the Identity Federation and Authentication Service of Finnish universities, to provide HACA integration to these EU services such as UDAT and Open Air and Zenodo. I'm not sure if this is technically feasible, but we are, well it's a wish list. And then another wish for this national service provider CSC would be for data sets to allocate these digital object identifiers. I don't know if this is feasible either, but anyway would like to raise this discussion. In Esa-Pekka's talk we just heard that this Federation of the Learned Societies is giving the DOIs of journals. But then for data, I don't know if it's CSC or the same federation. It would be nice if there was a national body giving out these DOIs, so that not every university would have to do it themselves. And yeah, I have like 5 minutes left.
Yeah, 5 minutes is fine.
Okay. Now then another thing about this combining openness and innovation, well this I already started with, this is a big thing for us and we have not solved this completely, but we are trying to pay some attention to this, we're trying to be the trailblazer among Finnish universities. We had a nice presentation yesterday from Denmark on how they are also trying to solve this somehow, so that you could both publish and commercialize. We have made some guidelines on this, that for example before filing the patent application you first keep your data confidential, and then after you have patented then you can publish your data and so on. And the key thing here is of course that the research data management is now essential, that you have to plan things in advance. You have to plan how you are going to store your data, and very essential is that you have to plan who have the rights of the data, and you have to have the agreements on the ownership of the data and the result, so that you don't run into problems later. So since we are talking about openness, I'll just briefly mention some other aspects of open science, namely the openness of scientific articles. Until now I have talked about data, but now a few words about open articles, open scientific publications. We have an internal repository for green open access, meaning that we self-archive, our library self-archiving the peer-reviewed publications in the form that is permitted by the publishers. They have different rules, but most often the publishers permit that the almost final version can be stored and self-archived by the university. So we have a repository, and that's already harvested into open air regarding journal publications. Then another thing we are now planning to do next year, and we have already budgeted some funding, is to support the open access publishing. And so that for the journals who require an extra fee for opening the article, that we would, as a university, we would be willing to pay for the price. This is, of course, a tricky question, because in some cases we have already paid a very high fee for the subscription of the journal, and then we would like pay them again, like in a different way. So in the long run, this is of course problematic, but we thought that in this period, a few years period, when we are heavily negotiating with the publishers, and we all know that there are very heated negotiations going on in these very days with publishers, we would actually be ready to cover the article processing charges for the researchers themselves. I mean, this is university-wide support for individual researchers. But we would only cover this for the highest quality journals. And you have heard about the Finnish journal ranking system, so it is called UFO. So there are tiers 1, 2, and 3, of which the 2 and 3 are the most prestigious ones. So we would cover any possible open access fees for those kinds of journal articles. So this is a pilot, and we will see how it goes and how much this is actually needed. And there are, well, we know that, for example, in Max Planck Library, they have negotiated a very fine deal with major publishers on not paying things twice. So in the end, of course, we strive for the same together with our other universities in the country. But this is a trial to support the down-to-earth work at grassroots level in our departments to support open access publishing. And the last thing I'll mention is openness of other activities. So the doctoral dissertations are published. We recommend development of open research methods and open source software. And very nice thing that I wish to emphasize is that the teaching materials of Aalto University are published in the My Courses portal, and the open access is a default option. So only in the case that the teacher wishes to specifically close the material, then it is not open access, but otherwise the default option is open access, and they really have a lot of materials, teaching materials, in open domain. This is a list of people who are working on it in the services of Aalto University. So we are both from research and innovation services and the library and the IT services. So this is a common effort of all these service functions. And we have some professors participating and advising us. So Pekka is here, and Petri Myllymäki is here, or Petri from University of Helsinki, actually. And we also wish to thank Helsinki University for collaboration. We are copying many good things that they have first done there. And Aalto is working for a better world. Thanks.
Okay. Thank you, Ella, for this kind of a view from the top, so to speak. Mm. So, any questions to Ella?
Okay.
Yes, okay. Yes.
Hi, Sami Niinimäki from Ministry of Education and Culture. Thank you, Ella, for the presentation. You mentioned that you request the researchers to follow the guidance of the publishers when, for example, self-archiving.
Yeah, yep.
How do you cope the, if the funders require a different embargo, for example, than the publishers, how do you cope these type of conflicts?
Well, we try to negotiate with the funder. I mean, if the publisher has the rights in the end, so, I mean, of course we would be as open as possible, but sometimes we have signed an agreement with the publisher and which restricts things in, yes. But it's a tricky question. We try to negotiate in both ways.
Can I continue? Yes. You had pretty clear rules on the licensing of the data.
Yeah, recommendation.
Recommendation, actually, yeah. Yes. Yeah. And I like it because it looked quite simple, so yeah. That I could understand it also. In some sense, are there any, let's say, more than you show here? Can, for example, the researcher license it only for teaching purposes, for example?
Yeah, that is of course possible, but not very many people are so aware of different licenses that they would have a personal view on this. So this is like the overall recommendation, but of course any licensing is good if you think about it. So
yeah. Okay, in any case, I mean I would say that the most used version, like the CC type of licensing, would make the world more compatible,
mm-hmm.
in some yeah. sense, and creating new ones, and for example, with tiny user base, makes it all the more complex and difficult to understand. So, with this as such, I think this is rather good.
Yeah, this yeah. is something we can give support on. So,
yeah.
Actually, can I continue on this? So, you said that okay, all our teaching materials are openly available. So,
by default, unless the teacher wants okay. to restrict the visibility.
So, yeah. What's the license on my teaching materials, which are up there? So,
I have to check, but I think it's Creative Commons.
I mean, I haven't thought about this at all.
Oh,
so
well, okay, let's see. What did I have here on my slide? I'm guessing it is Creative Commons.
Yeah.
BY.
I'm not sure that the teachers are somehow informed about this.
Well,
at all.
You didn't read this small print. Small print. Yeah.
Obviously, it didn't harm so far.
No, I'm happy with that, but I'm kind of happy to know that somebody has thought about this on my behalf, so I don't.
Yeah, we actually have a very good, Maria Rebinder, our IPR lawyer, is maybe the best expert in in Finnish universities on licensing. So.
Can I ask one more question? I don't know if this is very local, but you said that the metadata for publications will be kind of placed in this ACRIS system, which I think is a kind of a basically good idea. So the data is not there, but the metadata. So how does the metadata end up there? So are the
you mean data sets or journal publications?
Journal publications. So.
Well, it actually goes from this from this Aalto doc. The library puts things there, and it goes out automatically to ACRIS and automatically to OpenAir and various places.
Or maybe more in a more detailed way. So, for data, so do you have kind of metadata standards? So, if you want to put your data somewhere, and then the metadata has to go into this local research information system. Yeah. Is there a metadata standard that you are somehow imposing?
Well, this is ongoing work. I think what we are thinking now that it's up to the final destination, let's say Zenodo or anything, where the data is put. And that kind of metadata standard should be followed. I mean, it would be the easiest for the researcher.
Okay.
And ACRIS can handle a few metadata models, but,
okay.
but really, yeah, opening up the discussion on metadata models, it's a never-ending discussion. Yeah.
Okay.